panel discussion. The topic is on post-COVID interstitial lung disease syndrome, diagnosis and management as ILD, for which we have a very, very senior doctor who is going to moderate this session. And it's my pleasure and honor to introduce to all of you Dr. Sandeep Nair, sir. So Dr. Sandeep Nair, sir, has undergone several international training. He's undergone prospectorship in critical care from Brussels. He's gone training under sleep disorders management, trained in interventional bronchoscopy, medical thoracoscopy training from France. And he's also affiliated with several societies like Indian Society of Critical Care Medicine, National College of Chest Physician, Indian Association of Bronchology, Indian Chest Society, and Delhi Chest Forum as well. He's got a keen interest in intensive care and interventional pulmonology. He's one of the few pulmonologists in India who has performed both rigid and fiber optic bronchoscopy in adults as well as children. He's got several publications in his name, which have been published in both national as well as international journal. He's worked as the head of the unit at Jaipur Golden Hospital, worked as the head of the pulmonology of the department at Fortis Hospital in Delhi, and currently is associated as a senior director and head of department in Center for Chest and Respiratory Diseases at BLK Max Super Speciality Hospital at New Delhi. I think it is a pleasure to have you on board, sir. And without much wasting time, now I would like to hand over to Dr. Sandeep Nair, sir. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, friend, for a nice introduction. And it's my pleasure to be here sharing with you my my experience, and I also want to seek my friend's experience. It's been a tough time for all of us, COVID time, and we've all had our own experiences, our problems, our difficulties in treating them, because many times when the this particular monster came to us, we didn't know anything about it, how it's going to behave, how what is the treatment, or the no recommended treatment, and what are we going to do in our when we treat our patient. So what I'll do by the panel discussion, or the discussion which I'll be doing it, or we all will be doing it, upon the about the post-COVID interstitial lung disease syndrome. I'm sure most of us will agree that presently the COVID cases are down, fortunately, and hope it doesn't come again. But we are being, you know, troubled in treating this post-COVID syndrome, the post-COVID ILDs, the post-COVID, the long COVID, the COVID hall, the sickly, COVID tail, whatever we may call it. And we are having trouble treating these patients. So with me, it's my privilege that Dr. Rajput himself has agreed to be part of the panelists, and he is one of the most renowned chest physician of India. He's presently working as a head of a pulmonology department at Artemis Hospital, Gurugram. Before that, he was at Fortis Hospital, Shalimar Bagh, then Venkateshwar. Of course, we all know him. He has been a professor and head of respiratory department in the Army Hospital. He has organized a secretary cardiopulmonary. He was organizing secretary cardiopulmonary update on in September 2003. He has also received Major General Amir Chand Award. He's been invited in almost all renowned conferences, and I will be definitely looking upon him for his comment. Then we have our one of my very dear friend, Dr. Nitin Rathi, who is a pulmonologist at Dharamshila Narayana Super Specialty Hospital in Delhi. Before that, he was at Max Super Specialty Hospital and the Dr. BSA Ambedkar Hospital at Rohini. He has a special interest in EBUS and intervention bronchoscopies, also in critical care. And he has published various articles in reputed international and national journals. And he has been also been one of the faculty member in most of the conferences. And the ever-smiling Rahul Sharma is again a dear friend, and he's also is part of the panelists, and he's especially working as at Super Specialty Hospital in Noida. He's a fellow in American College of Chest Physician, fellow of National College of Chest Physician, and fellow of Indian Sleep Disorder. He has been a good teacher coordinator of DNB programs, has various publications to his Medium, more than 40 of them, and of course he received a Young Investigation Award from ICMI 2014 and Indian Chess Society 2014. So he's a dear friend, and I'm sure that he's also going to be continuing giving us his insight to most of them. So what have I done? I picked out 3 or 4 cases and quickly go through these cases. So these are not my cases, honestly speaking, and these are the cases, typical cases which we all gone through it. Deliberately didn't took my case because I wanted to see what has happened. Are we all, do we all agree to this particular treatment, or we have a different aspect to it? The treatment which was given need not be the right treatment with due respect to person, but maybe at that time this was the best treatment to be given. But what are we going to do now? Are we going in the same way, or are we not going to same way? So this is how I'll be carrying it on. So to carry with the first case, a gentleman, 84-year-old non-smoker, non-diabetic, presented with COVID infection. Fortunately, even at the age of 84 years, he did not have any comorbidities. He complained of low-grade fever and about 100 degree Fahrenheit. And he also talked about a dry cough for last 9 days. He was breathless at rest for past 2 days. His heart rate was 96 breath per minute. He was tachypneic, a respiratory of 28 per minute. His blood pressure was almost normal, blood pressure 142/86. But he was desaturated to some extent. His oxygen saturation on room air was 88%. So when this patient, typical patient comes to us with the COVID positive patient, how do we go about it? And I'll request our senior most panel member, at least Dr. Rajput, who's just like my elder brother, whom I really respect a lot and I've learned a lot from him. Sir, how would you go about for investigating these patients, sir? What will be the initial treatment approach, and whether we'll be requiring steroid, anticoagulant, or so? So please, could you please have your insight, please?
Can you hear me? Yeah.
Yes, sir, sure.
Oh, yeah. So first thing is to have a look at the chest X-ray, because he's having respiratory system involvement, COVID positive, his saturation is low. So what kind of opacities you see? So first and foremost thing, you know, see the chest X-ray in this patient. And we proceed after seeing the chest X-ray. In any case, symptomatic treatment for initial these patients, like some antibiotic and some cough syrup and something antipyretic, they have a standard role in all these cases. The role for antiviral is, you know, again, doubtful. None of the drug has been approved. Of course, we have been using off-label indication of antiviral with COVID positive in these patients. And I personally don't jump into the steroids. And reason being, you know, I need at least, you know, 2 visits of the patient, you know, or a declining trend, you know, the saturation dropping, only then I will use steroid. Or there is a lot of ground glass haze in the chest X-ray or CT, then I use steroid in this patient, especially, you know, 1 week has elapsed in this patient. And he falls in the bracket where we can safely use steroids, and he's non-diabetic. Anticoagulants, the pathology in COVID, we have learned over the period of time, there's a lot of vasculitis, a lot of thromboembolism, and endothelitis is there. So they are safe. They are safe. So there's no harm in continuing, because he's a elderly guy, and these patients, when they are resting, they are not moving, the thromboembolism as such is very high in these patients. So I can continue with anticoagulants, but I will need at least one more either a CT or X-ray to convince me that steroids will be given in these patients. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. And Rahul, do you have to add anything in it?
I think what sir says is absolutely right, that we need to evaluate these patients. 2 things we need to see. One is the pneumonia is there, which is probably and most probably it is there because the saturation is already 88, and this patient will definitely require steroid and other supportive care. The other thing that we need to see is basically whether the patient is going into or not. So for which we probably need all kind of lab parameters in terms of inflammatory markers. And on the basis of this, and maybe in a day or two, we decide if the patient is progressive very, very fast, probably immunomodulator has a role here.
Dr. Rathi?
I am agree with both of the speakers because patient is 84 of age. Patient is low general condition. We have to look all the parameters and we have to closely observe the patient. If the patient is deteriorating, then obviously we need steroid. And this patient should be kept in the hospital for observation, I would like to add.
So, as rightly said, we got a chest X-ray done, which showed extensive ground glass opacification in both lungs with peripheral predominance. The immediate examination showed almost normal with slight lymphopenia, that hemoglobin was 11.9 gram per cell. TLC was normal, platelets were okay, neutrophil 76%, lymphocytes were 19.5%. Now, with this, would we go with anything else? Any plasma, convalescent plasma, HRCT or inhaled bronchodilator? Rahul, can I have you first to go ahead with it?
I think it depends on in which part of the wave we are seeing this patient. If it is the first wave, then probably convalescent plasma is always on the card. If it is the second wave, we have our different thoughts. Different people were using different policies. And if it's the patient which is coming right now, then convalescent plasma has no role. It is out of the question. HRCT, again, does not give you much information until you feel that there is some superimposed infection, some kind of other complication that you are feeling that the patient has right now. Otherwise, there is no point sending a respiratory failure patient to HRCT and coming back because it adds no information as far as the treatment part is concerned. I would like to add definitely procalcitonin in these patients and the other inflammatory markers in terms of IL-6, D-dimer, ferritin level to just have a baseline value and to assess these patients over a period of time if the patient deteriorates. Inhaled corticosteroids, again, has a very, very, controversial role. In the initial part, some people are using it for the cough management. In the later part, some people using it as a bronchodilator and direct inhalation to the lung. But definitely, it has a controversial role. If the patient has any underlying baseline obstructive airway disease, probably it has a better role in that sense.
Dr. Rathi, would you like to add anything in this?
Yes, sir. Definitely in plasma is no role now. But if the patient is decreasing saturation, if patient is being critical, then I would like to add HRCT or it may be a need of CTPA because some minor thing like pneumothorax, pneumomediastinum or pulmonary embolism can be missed if the patient is not improving. And inhaled bronchodilator, there is no role of bronchodilator in this patient, but maybe give inhaled steroid because they can reduce the inflammation of the airways. So there is some role of inhaled steroid, but no role of bronchodilator as such.
You know, probably 84 year old with 88% saturation, there's always a challenge because this patient doesn't give much time because they have a very limited reserve. So in these patients, sometimes we have to act really fast. So your take, Dr. Rajput, sir?
You know, little low flow oxygen will improve his saturation. Mm-hmm. And of course, initial CT will give a lot of information because many times when, as you are saying, the patient deteriorates very fast, we are not in a position to do CT subsequently. So a lot of information CT has provided in these patients and should be done whenever the patient is hospitalized. Of course, I was against plasma right from the beginning. And now I hardly use for 2-3 patients and I didn't find any useful thing. Of course, the article in Lancet and NEJM highlighted the use of budesonide in improving these patients. So subsequently, we have all used budesonide nebulization. But bronchodilator will cause a lot of tachycardia and as such these patients have high pulse rates. So inhaled steroids are safer But if you are giving oral steroids or parenteral steroid to this patient, there is no point adding in inhaled steroid because they will work. They will work.
So, like we discussed in last slide, we are not going to go with steroid right now. So inhaled steroid might help to some extent because, like you rightly said, that giving steroid to all patients can be detrimental because this patient might have superadrenal infection. Like Rahul also put out a very pertinent point about the Procal, because many a time they may be having some superadrenal infection, and once you try to rule it out, steroid may be given. Of course, anticoagulant, we'll all agree that we'll all given it. Convalescent plasma, we is almost out of the window because now the even guidelines doesn't recommend it. There was a time when we were giving it, recommended also, and there was so much we talked about it. HRCT, I would agree with Dr. Rajput that in case you have the facilities in your hospital to get an HRCT and the patient is hospitalized, you please get it done because the patient will not give you time, might not give you time for getting it done afterwards. And like Rati rightly said, you might miss out some small pneumothorax. And I think everyone would agree with the second wave, we had a lot of pneumothoraces and pneumomediastinum, lot of them. And in first wave, they were not that high, but in the second wave, I must admit that we had so many of pneumothoraces and we had to place a tube. And of course, we also have to see for any embolism, but any most of the patients are all put on anticoagulant. But even if an HRCT, quick HRCT, many times CTP is not easy to get it done, a quick HRCT would definitely to rule out a pneumothorax at least.
So HRCT will not demarcate the thromboembolism.
That is what I'm saying. We may not go for the whole CTPF initially because we're not suspecting pulmonary embolism and all, but just to pneumothorax where I was suspecting or pneumomediastinum, a quick HRCT, we can quickly do it. Many times these patients have a deranged KFT or patients are too sick for a long study of the CT scan. At least a quick HRCT might give us some idea. If possible, we go for a CTPA. I totally agree with you. Until the contrast is given, we will not talk, not know about the vessels. This was an X-ray of the patients and which showed a diffuse ground glass opacities. Got a CT scan done, which showed extensive reticulation. And there was some bronchiectasis and a bronchiolitis. This gentleman was discharged after 6 days with the oxygen and antifibrotics, some inhaled bronchodilator and a low dose of prednisolone, that in fact 30 milligram, and was advised pulmonary rehabilitation. This was the treatment given to this patient, and we might not agree entirely on it, at least I don't. So let's see what is your take on it. Let's start with Dr. Rati this time.
Sir, definitely I am agree with the patient should be discharged on oxygenation. And antifibrotic may be plus or minus because the patient is at 84 of year age. If patient requirement is high and is still high at the end of discharge, it means the patient is on the fibrosis side, then I would like to add antifibrotic. Otherwise, if the patient is going better, oxygen requirement is low, antifibrotic is plus minus. Inhaled bronchodilator, as I said, ki there is no role of bronchodilator as such. Low dose of prednisolone, I would agree. And pulmonary rehabilitation, exercise, and anulom vilom kind of things, I agree. And some kind of supportive.
So treatment. You would add antifibrotic on 9th day because patient has a history of only 9 days with this picture. You plan to add antifibrotic. It's a matter of controversy because antifibrotic has still not proven role.
Yes, sir.
Both in nintedanib and pirfenidone. Will you add, Dr. Rahul?
Absolutely not, sir. So this depends, sir. Like if the CT scan of the patient is seen, which is 84-year-old, we don't know that this traction bronchiectasis and bronchiolectasis is because of the COVID that has happened to this patient. It might be a prior disease which is just going on, and we have seen some superimposed COVID infection in such patients. So these patients really need a long-term follow-up as far as the antifibrotic is concerned. Other thing that I would like to add in this patient is an anticoagulation at home. Because that is also very, very important in these patients, because still the patient will be immobilized at home. He might be on oxygen and all sorts of other things are there. So adding a anticoagulation also helps in such patients.
Yeah, because antifibrotic adding is a big risk we are doing it, because it's a controversial, first of all. And whatever studies or whatever things have been done, it has been added only in the later stage, not on the first 9 days or 10 days, because this fibrosis is different. And I think I'll carry on with this only to in the next slide and say, ask Dr. Rajput himself, sir, what do you think? What exactly causes a post-COVID fibrosis in most of the patients? And would you like to add the anti-fibrotic in this early?
Many of these patients, we see the pathogenesis is mainly, you know, immune dysregulation. Something like what we see in connective tissue disease related ILD. So same kind of phenomena occurs. There are a lot of interleukin-6, CRP or TGF-beta, TNF-alpha and myofibroblast and extracellular matrix, they start playing role. And there is, we know, increased angiotensin 2 in these patients. And of course, it is added by the, you know, lot of oxygen. Over-oxygenation also leads to some amount of fibrosis in these patients, which I have observed. And if they are ventilated, you know, ventilator-associated lung injury and fibrosis, they all contribute to fibrosis in these patients. And what was your next question?
Sir, I just the same thing. Would you like to add antifibrotic?
So no, definitely not. I usually delay to the maximum, and I need to convince myself that despite giving steroid, there is no improvement in the patient. Hypoxia is worsening, and the serial at least second CT 2 weeks showing, or if it is not possible, X-ray showing increase in the shadows. Increased fibrosis and reticulation, ground glassing being replaced by the reticulation and septal thickening and fibrotic changes. And once I'm convinced that the disease is progressive despite steroid and the patient is hypoxic, I usually give antifibrotic drugs in these patients, which is usually around, you know, third week or maybe later, not that early. And the second aspect is also there. If you delay antifibrotic, say 2 months or, you know, 6 weeks or 8 weeks, then the response may not be there. Because if you see the natural history of these shadows, more than 50% have been resolved and the X-ray have normalized. And it is only small, say 10% or 15%, they are progressively increasing. These are the candidates for antifibrotic. And rest 25-30%, they remain static. So nothing works in them also. So it's a calculated cost.
Yeah, it's in addition, if you think about to go about the how the mechanism, it causes more of, you know, epithelial damage rather than endothelial damage, which is done in the interstitial lung disease, which is normally seen. Second thing is adding antifibrotic so early, especially when these patients have got raised transaminases or liver function problems. Both of these, perfenex, perfenadone as well as nintedanib, they do cause liver toxicity also. So we should be very careful. And our experience, at least my experience, is that most of the patients, they resolve. And like you rightly said, we may follow up and see. I say, not even CT, even the patient's oxygen requirement has gone down. If patient has clinically got better, that itself shows that probably this progressive fibrosis is not there. Because patient is responding well to the treatment, or automatically patient is improving, then we might not do a CT scan in these patients. However, if the patient continue to deteriorate or they do not improve it, then we may do a further testing. If the patient is improving, we may not do it. So I think most of us agree that early introduction of anti-fibrotic is not required at all. Rahul, you wanted to say something?
Yeah, sir. So as far as these antifibrotics are concerned, nobody actually knows that when to add these antifibrotics. So everyone has their own policies and own experience. Like what I am doing, I am using it as a desperate measure. Like patient is in the hospital for a longer period of time. Oxygen requirement is persistently there. Patient is not improving. And this is the time when desperately you need to do something other than oxygen supportive care. So these are probably the patient in which I am starting antifibrotic. But as far as discharge patient are concerned, so if I am discharging my patient is definitely improving. And these patients usually do not need antifibrotic, as you and sir said, that probably 99% of these fibrosis are improving. So these are not IPF, which is creating a lot of chaos that the lifespan is 3 to 5 years and all. Probably whether you see first wave or second wave, if the patient survives and went home, most of these fibrosis are improving by itself. They don't need any kind of antifibrotic. Most of the patients whom we have started antifibrotics usually are those who were stuck up in the ICUs or had a prolonged hospitalized stay in which we have started antifibrotics, and we are planning to, you know, titrating, looking at the lung function, whether it is improving or not, and probably whether it is actually doing anything to these patients or not, we don't know. But yes, antifibrotic is a desperate drug, what I call it, when we have nothing and we don't know what to do, we add antifibrotic to these patients.
Absolutely. And I this is a at least carry home message for most of us, this antifibrotic not to be added just like it. It should be added only if you really think there's no other option under desperate situation. Not to be added to until unless you really think that it is important. Do you think that all these patients require a pulmonary follow-up, all of them? And another to this question only, if I may add it, what are the patients you really think will develop a pulmonary fibrosis? Who are those patients you will think, yes, probably this is an early predictor, these patients might develop early fibrosis. Rati, if you can start with it.
Sir, early predictor of the pulmonary fibrosis is elderly patient, severity of the patient, duration of the stay in the ICU, and the how much is the oxygen demand, and history of alcohol and smoking definitely are the bad predictors of the pulmonary fibrosis.
Sir, anything you would like to add, Dr. Rajput, sir?
All those patients, what he highlighted, are absolutely correct. But in addition, those patients who are on mechanical ventilation, they invariably, you know, they go into fibrosis. And all those who were on high flow oxygen, high oxygen therapy, hyperoxia also causes more of fibrosis in these patients. And of course, those who have got secondary infection also leads to fibrosis. So in addition to old age, severe disease, comorbidity, smoking, and oxygenation, ventilation, these are the patients who lead to fibrosis. And of course, prolonged stay. The longer the stay in the ICU, the more the fibrosis is.
And I think, sir, you would also agree with me that all these patients do require a pulmonary follow-up when they go home. I mean, this is not that once discharged, they're discharged. Especially, I'm talking about the admitted patients. Your take on it, sir?
All patients should be followed because we have seen late recrudescence of fibrosis in some of these patients.
Absolutely.
And some of them, you know, they may be hidden very small ILD earlier, IPF, you know, which was unnoticed. And when you follow, it you know, reveals itself. And at least you follow these patients till their saturation is optimal 98 or so, and it does not fall on 6-minute walk test and they are asymptomatic and x-rays are near normal. So you follow these patients definitely at least for 2-3 months, all of them.
Agreed. So I think even that one of the consensus in the Swiss guideline, also they talk about it, that 3 months follow-up is, especially the sick patient who are admitted patient. I'm not talking about the patient who are your OPD patient, because many of them do require so much treatment. But those patients who are there, who are requiring even domiciliary oxygen, who were even required, who are discharged even on anticoagulant and steroid, they should be followed up. A question to do you, Rahul, because you put out a very important point about the anticoagulant at home. How long would you like to give anticoagulant to these patients?
It is again a very, very difficult question, sir. But I believe that you need to calculate the risk factors of the patient, whether the patient is immobilized, not immobilized, the underlying condition, especially if the patient has diabetes, which is most of the time uncontrolled in such patients, looking at the D-dimer values and the oxygen of the patient. So my simple criteria which I follow is, till the time patient is on oxygen, I would like to give them anticoagulation. And after that, if the D-dimer is normalized, 2 weeks or 4 weeks is what we are following. But yes, there is no specific guidelines which says that you need to follow these patients for 3 months or so. So everybody has their own opinion. This is what I follow. If the patient is on oxygen, the patient is on anticoagulation also. If the patient is stabilized at home, mobilized, and other parameters and risk factors are not there, I would like to stop it after 2 weeks.
You will be discharging them on NOACs or
yes,
injectable?
Yes, sir.
No X. Yeah. And see, again, another controversial point is about the D-dimer. There are studies which say that even D-dimer doesn't correlate with the coagulation at home. Though this is one of the parameter we take it, but still, there's a controversial about D-dimer also. So again, another controversial point about the anticoagulant, of course, most of them, you rightly said, if the patient is, say, underlying COPD, diabetic, oncology patients, those bedridden patients, definitely you tend to give them anticoagulant for a longer time. Otherwise, most of the patients, you don't give it for a very long time, maybe a week or so, and then you, once they start moving and around, you tend to stop it out. A good question on D-dimer also. Let's go to a second case. 59-year-old, this gentleman was a smoker, 40 pack year. With subarachnoid hemorrhage and obesity. So we have got so many comorbid conditions in this patient. He came out as a COVID positive and presented to us with a 15 days of symptoms before coming to the hospital. He was in the hospital for 8 days and discharged later. The oxygen supplementation on which he was discharged was on 4 liter per minute. After 60 days, he reported with fatigue and some depression, a BDI of 3, if we talk about Baxter depression inventory of 3, that's not very high, small, some depression. And I think most of us will agree that a lot of our patients do talk about the psychological problem also when they come back to us, especially the sick patients, brain fogging, depression, etc. Now, his patient's bronchodilator, post-BD spirometry was normal. His saturation was also good. His 6-minute walk test was also good. So this patient otherwise was quite stable. Now, this gentleman was, if you see the CT scan on admission, did show some fibrotic band and some patchy infiltrations and reticulation. But after 90 days of the discharge, and a repeat CT scan done, his CT scan was quite encouraging. So, again, he was not given any antifibrotic. So that, again, this comes to our question. Do you think all lung fibrosis following COVID-19 infection is progressive? And should we do routinely a CT scan? Most of the questions we have discussed it before, but let's quickly redo it. And especially those patients who present with interstitial abnormality, should they receive an empiric steroid systemic trial? And, you know, again, what about the antifibrotic? So, sir, please, if you can just start with it, Dr.
I do CT in all these patient follow-up. Those who have shown, you know, early ground glassing or fibrosis evidence, as in this case, it has to be seen after, say, 8 weeks or so, what is the status. And majority, I told you earlier also, more than 50%, they recover without significant residual fibrosis, as happened in this case. And there is no point in giving steroid in each and every case with interstitial abnormalities, because there are many factors for interstitial abnormalities. You know, many of these patients may have fluid overload because of the cardiac involvement. We have seen cardiomyopathy occurring in COVID. We have seen the fluid overload due to so many reasons in these patients causing interstitial abnormalities. So unless until the patient is hypoxic, severely hypoxic, ground glassing is a stronger indication for giving systemic steroid rather than interstitial opacities. And interstitial opacity is the later stage of ground glassing when things are almost improving or they are residual and permanent and not causing much of physiological abnormalities, like in this case. So when ground glassing is there, I use steroid in these patients, not for all interstitial abnormalities. And antifibrotic, we have discussed, like majority of the cases, they improve. Unless until they show progressive deterioration, I don't use antifibrotic drugs in these patients.
Dr. Rathi?
Yes, sir. I am do agree with that, sir. But in this case, issue is also a psychological issue. All we are talking about antifibrotics and coagulations, but I do say ki we have to see the psychological issue also, because sometimes psychological issue also increase the breathlessness and the symptoms. So I would like to address some anti-depression or anti-anxiety medicine and the psychological support also.
Absolutely, because this patient is talking about depression, etc., and they tend to recover slowly because of their psychological problem rather than physical problem, because physically he was good, he was maintaining his saturation, etc. Another thing, Rahul, coming back to you for the same reason, subarachnoid hemorrhage. What about anticoagulant in this? This patient had a history of subarachnoid hemorrhage. Now this
If it is less than 3 months, it is absolutely no contraindication for using anticoagulation in such patient, unless we prove that the pro-inflammatory state or the propensity of development of pulmonary embolism is very, very high. If the patient is maintaining saturation, I think you will keep this patient in mild to moderate category. Even steroids needs to be decided whether it has to be given to such patient or not. Anticoagulation definitely is a very, very difficult decision to take. But yes, if the patient has no other comorbidity, I would rather try to observe this patient for some time until the patient shows some sign of progression of the disease.
So that's what we were discussing. This case was particular for this particular reason. One, of course, Dr. Rathi pointed out a very important thing about the psychotic behavior also, which we must take care of it. Dr. Rathwad put out a very important point about the repeat CT scan. In these patients, if there's early, when the first CT showed some changes, and you really wanted to follow up. And the third thing for which this case was taken was about the anticoagulant. And I think, Rahul, I just caught you for that, because there's some patient where we are in a catch-22 situation.
Absolutely.
We had patients with dengue and COVID also when they came to us, with platelets of 35,000, 36,000. Again, a difficult situation. Whether to give...
I think you give steroid first. If the platelet improves, then give anticoagulant.
You know, anticoagulant again was a challenge in right. this patient. We had patients with hemoptysis. Right. We had patients with hemoptysis with the COVID. Yeah. Again, whether to give anticoagulant or not. So there have been a challenges when they treat these patients, because a blanket treatment is okay for most of the patients, but there will be another subset which will really, you know, trouble you. So this hemoptysis, the dengue, and the subarachnoid hemorrhage or bleeding from any other part, will you give these anticoagulant? It's again a challenge which we talk about. And then why I asked about the NOACs is that many of the NOACs doesn't have the reversals. Many of them.
Yes, of course. Absolutely.
So then again it's a challenge that in case the patient start bleeding, then what are you going to do? And which NOAC do you prefer, Rahul?
So we give only pentaxide in this patient, which has it. And many times my threshold for anticoagulant only ecosperin in these patients rather than going for NOACs.
So I also follow the same protocol, sir. If we feel that the D-dimer is normal, patient is quite stabilized, it is only the pneumonia that we are looking at. Ecosperin do a wonderful job, especially in old age people where the risk of bleeding is very, very high. Otherwise, my favorite is apixaban because the doses and loading dose, and there is no hassle of such kind of thing, and it is very, very cheaply available to each and every corner of the market.
Now, though, even other NOAC is also easily available at the cheaper price, right? Because now we have the indigenous preparation, the Indian preparation, so they are also now available.
So people are using rivaroxaban also, but I don't know why people are not using a loading dose. And again, the dose that most of what I see is suboptimal, and I try to look into the literature. There is not much literature about this. So apixaban is the standard dose that safeguard you also. Probably that is the reason I am using apixaban over rivaroxaban.
Good. So let's go to quickly on one. We have got two more cases, but I'll do only one more because of the lack of the time. So quickly go through the this case, because again, there's something to more about talk about it. A 58-year-old gentleman with fever and cough came with breathlessness for last 4 days. He has been smoker and alcoholic for last 20 days. There's no history of diabetes, hypertension, and a COVID. He had a COVID about 45 days back. Now, this is already treated 45 days back, COVID, which is now presenting to us. And this time, his RT-PCR, of course, was negative. Now, this has come with a cough and a fever to you with expectoration and breathlessness. How will you go with it, Rahul?
The most common reason which I am seeing in this season is flu. All of them are developing superimposed flu. So starting these patients directly on anti-flu does no harm. But definitely we need to evaluate these patients as the patient has prior history of COVID. We don't know the severity, whether there is any associated residual lung disease which is persistent there, and look into the blood profile, X-ray picture of the patient. Probably doing serum IgG for Aspergillus or Galactomen also do some good. But in this particular season, everyone comes out influenza positive.
But many times, Rahul, you would agree with me that even the COVID patient who were totally cured, totally, in fact, they were totally treated, and suddenly after 5-7 days, they start having low-grade fever. And yes, you try to find out any reason, you're not able to find out. And
so I think,
you find out and you say, probably, sir, post-COVID sequelae, which has now occurred. And to come with this thing, what do you do? How do you classify the post-COVID, a long COVID, a COVID hollers, and the 3 weeks, 12 weeks demarcation? How do we do that?
So I think this is a problem, and probably every patient is now literate enough to decide whether this fever, and they all come up with a differential diagnosis nowadays. So what you need to do is, the most common thing that we are seeing in these patients, if the patient is female, then UTI is the most common thing which is persistent in these patients because of steroid use, long-term use of other immunosuppressants. But yes, definitely all these patients have to be screened thoroughly before labeling these patients as long COVID syndrome. And after that, giving a short course of antibiotic, procalcitonin, urine, routine blood test, all these things need to be seen. The other important thing is ESR and CRP again has a very, very good value. If it is persistently rising, then you need to look into some underlying cause. If it is on the same range or going down, but the fever is there, then probably all these patients has, you know, sequel of COVID, which you can say long COVID syndrome or post-COVID complication. But I have, I think, 10 or 12 such patients who were after my life, and I just thoroughly evaluate these patients and said that you need to just follow yourself. And if your change in the pattern of fever in terms of increase in the spike of fever or if you have any kind of localized symptom to any system, then probably you need an evaluation again. Otherwise, most of these patients are doing well without any medication.
I want to
add, sir, your take on it, Dr. Rajput, sir. I think you must have also come across these patients.
This is the most interesting, you know, case you have brought in, and very common problem of fever post-COVID.
That's right.
And we all have seen, you know, long COVID and fever. You see, these fever, if they are less than 100 degree, they are usually not significant. And any significant fever, like Rahul has said, you know, you do complete workout in these patients, because many of them, they have developed black fungus also and caused fever in these patients. So you have to rule out all those things, possible secondary infection, procal and other things. But if everything is normal and the fever is persisting, and if it is less than 100 degree, so it is usually a problem of thermoregulation, which is a very common problem after the COVID. Now, we all know there is a hypothalamus and there is a thermoregulation in the body. And all these patients have had steroid in a very random way, you know, morning, afternoon, evening, late evening, at their own will, whatever time. See, steroids, whenever to be given, has to be given early morning, because the circadian rhythm of steroids, we all know, is 7:30 or 8 a.m. is the peak in the body. So you maintain that peak. What I've given is, given them a very short course of steroid after evaluating this patient for a little longest time, 2-3 weeks, and gradually tapering to a very small Ellicott's. You know, even if you give 10 milligram prednisolone and taper off to 7.5 and 5 and 2.5 for 2 weeks, usually fever abates in these patients. So this is my take.
So, sir, this brings a smile on my face, because that's exactly, I have done it. And there's no guidelines, you know. And you know, in the sense that for the COVID, you see, once what you do, you thoroughly investigate, you don't find out anything, just give a small steroid, the patient recover, and fortunately that fever doesn't come back again. And of course, I agree with you.
Little longer time.
So what I've done is, my patient have really responded very well, just to small dose of steroid, 5 to 10 days, and then the fever did come back. So probably there's some inflammation still going on even after COVID, which probably had taken care of. We don't know. So, but I think most of us are doing the same thing.
I want to add one thing.
Please, sir.
Because I have also seen these kind of cases, and there are 3-4 patients which is coming from a second opinion for fever after 3 months of COVID. I have naproxen. I have added naproxen. It is a very calculated drug in the rheumatoid arthritis. Is a non-inflammatory drug, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug. And when I am giving naproxen, it is a wonderful drug, and I am able to stop steroid also. So I think there is some role of naproxen also in these kind of patient. I think we should also try it.
Yeah, I agree with you, Dr.
We have used naproxen also.
Naproxen, I think most of us are using it, even in the COVID also, not only in the post-COVID, even during COVID, many of us are giving naproxen as an anti-inflammatory and because to remove to relieve of the fever. Now, this gentleman was a known case of ILD. In fact, this gentleman was a case of CPFE, the combined pulmonary fibrosis and emphysema. And of course, he was hypoxic, but when you saw his X-ray, so you saw the multiple bullae, if you can appreciate out there. And you gave them a little bit of steroid, they responded well, because he's already a case of ILD. Now, to this, I would like to ask another question from my fellow panelists is that, what about a patient who are already in ILD? We had a lot of patients, right? I had a patient of IPFs developing a COVID, these patients. Does COVID infection at that particular time, does it further deteriorate the cause of deterioration of these ILDs, exacerbation of the ILDs? And is it reversible, whatever deterioration it has caused during the COVID? Sir, your take, Dr. Rajput?
This is common in all ILD patients who develop COVID, they deteriorated. And they will never come to their pre-COVID times. They will never come to their pre-COVID times. Some deterioration in lung function will persist, and it is progressive. Some improvement will occur, of course, with steroid we give in these patients. But the usual treatment for ILD, whatever he or she is on, perphenidone and intilanib, should continue. And it should be stepped up by steroid in this acute exacerbation. And I have seen if they were maintaining saturation of 88 pre-COVID, after COVID, they are around 85, 83, something like that. They are never pre-COVID levels.
What is your take, Rahul, about these patients? Do you think there is something special for these patients, how we should treat it? How do we treat with the COVID, ILD and the non-ILD COVID?
I think continuing the antifibrotics, adding good amount of steroids after ruling out infection, and good amount of oxygen. Only these things work, but definitely, as I said, that most of these patients have some increase in the residual disease when these patients are recovering. Most of these patients are the ones who are developing pneumothorax and all kind of pneumomediastinum and these complications when we are treating these patients. So these are the most difficult patient to treat, but continuing the antifibrotic for the baseline underlying ILD, adding steroids and covering with antibiotics is probably the best way out for such patient. That is how I treating this patient.
And I have your last comment, Nitin, before I wind up, because the time is going on. Nitin?
I do agree with Dr. Rahul and sir. Fully agree.
So, I know there was a lot of things which were to be discussed, but we mainly, I think, touched upon every aspect of the post-COVID fibrosis. We had one or two cases more, but I would not like to take more time because there's another talks going on. And I would definitely like to thank all my panelists, with special thanks to Dr. Rajput, because he's like an elder brother to me. And of course, my friends, Rahul and Nitin Rathi, with whom I can take a liberty of any time to discuss with them. And with this, I would like to end this panel discussion.